That's a good question. Why am I standing out here alone? I guess I don't know enough to comment from the rain. Was watching your window from here below.
And I'd like to welcome you to Haggerty Auditorium and the Fitch High School fall production. For those of you who were sold tickets under the impression you were getting back-to-back showings of Les Miserables followed by Phantom of the Opera, we apologize that was a miscommunication. We're substituting those two shows with a fine production of Harvey, which brings us to our program. After carefully looking at the butterfly program, we find that a recount was necessary, and for some of the offices here, the new winners based on a hand recount are Miss Myrtle Mae Simmons is played by Ashley Nespetal. Veta Louise Simmons is played by Nicole Hume. And Miss Johnson is played by Jacqueline Knuckles. She's in the right spot, just misspelled her name. And we have Mrs. Ethel Chauvenet is played by Jamie Densmore. And Ruth Kelly, registered nurse, is played by Rebecca Curtin. And finally, Mrs. Betty Chumley is played by Shadeen Zach. We apologize for any confusion that our program might have caused. And again, welcome. I hope you enjoy the show.
But she has guests this afternoon. Who wants her?
Oh, wait just a minute. Mother.
Yes, dear?
Telephone.
Oh, no. Dear, not with all them in there. Say I'm busy.
But, Mother, it's the society editor of the Evening Newsbeat.
Oh, the society editor. She's very important.
Good afternoon, Miss Ellaby.
This is Veta Simmons.
Yes, a teen reception for the members of the Wednesday Forum. You might say program tea. My mother, you know, the late Marcella Penny Dowd, pioneer cultural leader. She came here by ox team as a child, and she founded the Wednesday Forum. Myrtle, how many would you say?
75 at least. Say 100.
75. Miss Tewksbury is a soloist, accompanied by Wilda McCurdy.
Mother, Mrs. Tewksbury's almost finished with her number.
She'll do an encore.
But what if they don't give her a lot of applause?
I've known her for years. She'll do an encore. You might say that I'm entertaining, assisted by my daughter, Miss Myrtle Mae Simmons. What color would you call her?
Rancho Rose, they told me.
Miss Myrtle Mae Simmons looked charming in a modest Rancho Rose toned crop, picked up at the girdle with a touch of magenta. I wish you could see her, Miss Ellaby.
Mother, Miss Tewksbury's almost finished. And where's the caterers?
Everything's ready. The minute she's finished singing, we open those dining room doors and begin pouring. The parlors and halls are festooned with smilers. Yes, festooned. Yes. That's right, Miss Ellaby. This is the first party we've had in years. There's a reason, but I don't want it in the papers. The guest list? Oh, yes.
Mother, come.
If you'll excuse me now, I'll call you later.
Mother, Miss Chauvenet just came in.
Mrs. Eugene Chauvenet Sr. Her father was a scout with Buffalo Bill.
Oh, so that's where she got that hat.
Myrtle, you must be nice to Mrs. Chauvenet. She has a grandson about your age.
Well, what difference will it make with Uncle Elwood?
Myrtle May, remember, we agreed not to talk about that this afternoon. The point of this whole party is to get you started. We work through those older women to the younger group.
We can never have anyone here in the evenings, and that's when men come to see you, in the evenings. The only reason we can even have a party this afternoon is because Uncle Elwood is playing Pinochle at the 4th Avenue Firehouse. thank God for the firehouse.
I know, but they'll just have to invite you out, and it won't hurt them one bit. Oh, Myrtle, you've got so much to offer. I don't care what anyone says. There's something sweet about every young girl, and a man takes that sweetness and look what he does with it. But you've got to meet somebody, Myrtle. That's all there is to it.
If I do, they'll say, that's Myrtle May Simmons. Her uncle's Elwood P. Dowd, the biggest screwball in town. Elwood P. Dowd and his pal.
You promise.
All right, let's get them into the dining room.
Now, when the members of the Wednesday Forum come in here and you make your speech on behalf of your grandmother, be sure to do this.
And then I'll mention a few words about my Uncle Elwood and his pal, Harvey. Damn, Harvey.
That's right, Myrtle May. Let everybody in Wednesday Forum hear you. You said that name. You promised you wouldn't say it, and you said it.
I'm sorry, Mother. But how do you know Uncle Elwood won't come in here and introduce Harvey to everybody?
Myrtle, this is unkind of you. Elwood is the biggest heartache I have. Even if people do call him peculiar, he's still my brother, and he won't be home this afternoon.
Are you sure?
Of course I'm sure.
But, Mother, why can't we live like other people?
Must I remind you again? Elwood is not living with us. We are living with him.
Living with him and Harvey. Did Grandmother know about Harvey?
I've wondered and wondered about that. She never wrote to me if she did.
Why did she have to leave all of her property to Uncle Elwood?
Well, I suppose it was because she died in his arms. People are sentimental about things like that.
You always say that, and it doesn't make sense. She couldn't have made out her will after she died, could she?
Don't be didactic, Myrtle May. It's not becoming any young girl, and men love it. Now, don't forget to wave your hand.
I'll do my best.
Oh, dear, Miss Tewksbury's voice is certainly fading.
But not fast enough.
Lovely, Mrs. Tewksbury. I loved it.
Excuse me, Harvey. That is the phone.
Hello? Oh, I'm sorry. You're the wrong number. But how do you do anyway? This is Elwood P. Dowd speaking. Oh, I'll do? Well, thank you. And what is your name, my dear? Miss Ellie Greenwald? Harvey, it's Miss Ellie Greenwald. Hello, Mrs. Greenwald. And how do you do today? That's fine. Oh, yes. I'd be happy to join your club. I belong to several clubs already. The University Club, the Country Club, and the Peanut Club, down at the 4th Avenue Firehouse. I spend a good deal of my time there, or over at Charlie's Place, or Eddie's Bar. What is your club, my dear? Harvey, I have the Ladies' Home Journal, Good Housekeeping, and the Open Room for Boys for 2 years for $6.25. Oh yes, it sounds fine to me. How does it sound to you, Harvey? Harvey says it sounds fine to him also. Yes, 2 subscriptions. Mail everything to this address. I do hope I have the pleasure of meeting you sometime. Harvey, she says she would like to meet me. Well, when? When would you like to meet me, Miss Grunewald? Well, why not now? My sister seems to be having a few guests over, and we would consider it an honor if you come and join us. Oh, yes, my sister, she would be delighted. Yes, 343 Temple Drive. I do hope to see you in a very few minutes. Goodbye, my dear. Harvey, don't you think we better freshen up? Yes, as do I.
I can't seem to remember where I put that guest list. I must read it to Miss Ellaby. Have you seen it, Miss Johnson?
No, I haven't, Mrs. Simmons.
Look on my dresser.
Mother, Miss Chauvenet, she's asking for you. Here's Mother, Miss Chauvenet. Here she is.
Betty Louise Simmons, I thought you were dead.
Aunt Bethel! Oh, no, I'm very much alive, thank you.
And this full-grown girl's your daughter? I haven't known you since you were a baby.
I know.
What's your name, dear?
This is Myrtle, Aunt Bethel. Myrtle May, but the 2 sisters of her father. He's dead, that's what confused you.
Oh, where's Elwood?
He couldn't be here.
Elwood isn't here?
No.
Oh, shame on him. That was the main reason I came. I want to see Elwood.
Oh, come, there are loads of people anxious to speak to you.
But do you realize better? It has been years since I've seen Elwood.
No, where does the time go?
I was saying to Mr. Chauvenet only the other night, what on earth has happened to Elwood Dowd? He never comes to the club dances anymore. I haven't seen him at a horse show in years. Does Elwood see anybody these days?
Oh, yes, Aunt Ethel. Elwood sees somebody.
Oh, yes. Your Uncle Elwood, child, is one of my favorite people. Always has been.
Yes, I remember.
Is Elwood happy, Beta?
Elwood is very happy, Aunt Ethel. You don't need to worry about Elwood. Why, there's Mrs. Frank Cummings just came in. Don't you want to speak to her?
My, but she looks ghastly. Hasn't she failed, though?
If you think she looks badly, you should see him.
Oh, is that so? I must have them over for dinner. She looks frightful. I thought she was dead.
Oh, no.
Now, what about tea, Beta?
Certainly, if you'll forgive me, I will precede you.
Elwood! Elwood Dowd! Bless your heart!
Aunt Ethel, what a pleasure. It's come upon a beautiful woman waiting for me.
Oh, Elwood, you haven't changed.
Come along, Aunt Ethel. You mustn't miss the party.
There's punch if you don't like tea.
Stop pulling at me, you two. Elwood, what night next week can you come over for dinner?
Any night at all, Aunt Ethel. I would be delighted.
Elwood, there's some mail for you today. I took it upstairs to your room.
Did you, Beta? That was nice of you. Aunt Ethel, I want you to meet Harvey. As you can see, he's a pooka. Harvey, you've always heard me speak of Mrs. Chauvenet. We've always called her Aunt Ethel. She's one of my oldest and dearest friends. Yes, she's the one. This is the one. He says he would have known you anywhere. Harvey, don't you think we better say hello to all our friends? Excuse me, Aunt Ethel.
Uh-huh.
You're standing in his way.
No.
Aunt Ethel, I can see you're concerned about Harvey. Please don't be. He stares like that at everyone. It's his way, but he liked you. He liked you very much.
Some tea, perhaps?
Not right now. I think I'll be running along.
But I'm so sorry.
I'll be talking to you soon. Goodbye.
Oh, God. Oh, my God. Myrtle, where are you going?
Up to my room. He's introducing Harvey to everybody. I can't face those people now. I wish I were dead.
Come back here. Stay with me. We'll get to Myrtle there and upstairs to his room.
I won't do it. I can't.
Myrtle, May. Now pretend I'm fixing your croissant.
Mother.
We've got to. Pretend we're having a gay little chat. Keep looking. When you catch his eye, tell me. He always comes when I call him. Now then, do you see him yet?
No, not yet. How do you do, Mrs. Cummings?
Smile, can't you? Have you no pride?
I'm smiling.
And he's my own brother.
Mother, people get run over by trucks every day. Why can't something like this happen to Uncle Elwood?
Myrtle May Simmons, I'm ashamed of you. This thing is not your uncle's fault.
That's Miss Elwood. Keep looking. Keep smiling.
Hello? This is Mrs. Simmons. Should you come with the clothes you have on? What have you on? Who is this? But I don't know any Miss Greenewalt. Should you what? May I ask who invited you? Mr. Dowd. Thank you just the same, but I believe there has been a mistake. Well, I never...
Never what?
One of your uncle's friends, she asked me if she should bring a quart of gin to the Wednesday forum.
There he is. He's talking to Miss Hallisey.
Is Harvey with him?
What a thing to ask. How can I tell? How can anyone tell but Uncle Elwood?
Oh, Elwood, could I see you a moment, dear? I promise you, your Uncle Elwood has disgraced us for the last time in this house. I'm
I'm going to do something I've never done before.
What did you mean just then when you said it wasn't Uncle Owen's fault? If it's not his fault, then whose fault is it?
Never you mind. I know whose fault it is. Now lift up your head and smile and go back in as though nothing has happened.
You're no match for Uncle Owen.
Oh, you'll see.
Mother's waiting for you.
Edward, could I see you a moment, dear?
Certainly, sister.
Edward, would you mind sitting down in here and waiting for me until the party is over? I want to talk to you. It's very important.
Oh, yes. I happen to have some free time right now, and you're welcome to all of it. Would you like Harvey to wait, too?
Yes, Elwood, I certainly would.
Jane Austen. Have a seat, Harvey. Vetta wanted to speak to us. She said it was important. I think she wants to congratulate us on the impression we made at her party. Huh? Yes? Jane Austen, Deluxe Edition. Reset and done now. In spite of all her deeply rooted dislike, she could not be insensible to the completeness.
Mrs. O.R. Simmons, 343 Temple Drive. Is that right?
We were born and raised there. It's old, but we love it. It's our home.
And you wish to enter your brother here at the sanitarium for treatment. Your brother's name?
It's... Oh...
Mrs. Simmons, what is your brother's name?
I'm sorry. Life is not easy for any of us. I'll have to hold my head up and go on just the same. That's what I keep telling Myrtle May. And that's what Myrtle May keeps telling me. She's heartbroken about her Uncle Elwood P. Dowd, that's it.
Elwood P. Dowd. His age?
47, the 24th of last April. He's Taurus. Taurus the bull. I'm Leo, and Myrtle is on a cusp.
47. Is he married?
Oh, no. Elwood has never married. He stayed home with Mother. He was always a great homeboy. He loved his home.
Do you have him with you now, Mrs. Simmons?
He's in the taxicab down in the driveway. I gave the driver a dollar to watch him, but I didn't tell the man why. You can't tell these things to perfect strangers.
Mr. Wilson, Would you please step down to a taxi in the driveway and ask a Mr. Dowd if he would be good enough to step up to room number 24, South Wing G?
Ask him?
This is his sister, Mrs. Simmons.
Yes, I'll be glad to escort him.
Thank you. The rates here, Mrs. Simmons, you'll find them printed on this card.
That will all be taken care of by my mother's estate, Lake Marcella Pinney Dow. Judge Gaffney is our attorney.
I'll see if Dr. Sanderson can see you now.
Dr. Sanderson? I want to see Dr. Chumley himself!
Oh, Mrs. Simmons, Dr. Sanderson is the one who sees everybody. Dr. Chumley sees no one.
He's still the head of this institution, isn't he? He's still a psychiatrist, isn't he?
Still a psychiatrist? Dr. Chumley is much more than that. He is a psychiatrist with a national reputation. Whenever people have nervous breakdowns, they at once think of Dr. Chumley.
Well, that's his office, isn't it? You march right in there and tell him I want to see him. If he knows who's out here, he'll come out.
I wouldn't dare disturb him, Mrs. Simmons. I would be discharged if I did.
Well, I don't like to be pushed off onto any second fiddle.
Dr. Sanderson is nobody's second fiddle. He's young, of course, and he hasn't been out of medical school very long. But Dr. Chumley tried 12 and kept Dr. Sanderson. He's really wonderful. To the patients.
Very well, tell him I'm here.
Right away.
Oh dear.
Bella, isn't this wonderful?
Yes, we have a seat, please.
Thank you. I hope you don't think I'm jumpy like this all the time, but I...
Of course not. You're concerned about your brother, Elwood P. Dowd?
Yes, Doctor, this isn't an easy one for me, Doctor.
Naturally, these things aren't easy for the families of the patients. I understand.
It's what Elwood's doing to himself, Doctor. That's the thing. Myrtle May has a right to nice friends. She's young and her whole life is before her. That's my daughter.
Your daughter. How long has it been since you began to notice any peculiarities in your brother's actions?
I noticed it right away when Mother died and Myrtle May and I came back home from Des Moines to live with Elwood. I could see
That he what? Take your time, Mrs. Simmons. Don't strain. Let it come. I'll wait for it.
Doctor, everything I say to you is confidential, isn't it?
That's understood.
Because it's a slap in the face to everything we've stood for in this community, the way Elwood is acting now.
I'm not a gossip, Mrs. Simmons. I'm a psychiatrist.
Well, for one thing, he drinks.
To excess?
To excess? Well, don't you call it excess when a man never lets a day go by without stepping into one of those cheap taverns, sitting around with the riffraff and people you never heard of, inviting them to the house, playing cards with them, giving them food and money. And here I am trying to get Myrtle May started off with a nice group of young people. If that isn't excess, I'm sure I don't know what excess is.
Well, I didn't doubt your statement, Mrs. Simmons. I merely asked if your brother drinks.
Well, I say definitely Elwood drinks. And I want him committed out here permanently, because I cannot stand another day of that rabbit. Our friends never come to see us. Myrtle May and I have to set a place at the table for Harvey. We have to move over on the sofa to make room for Harvey. We have to answer the telephone when Elwood calls on us to speak to Harvey. And then at the party this afternoon with Mrs. Chauvenet there, we didn't even know anything about Harvey until we came back here. Don't you think it would have been a little kinder of Mother to have written and told me about Harvey? Be honest now, don't you?
Well, I really couldn't answer that question, Mrs. Simmons, because I...
I can. Yes, it certainly would have.
Who is this Harvey?
He's a rabbit.
Perhaps, but just who is he?
Doctor, I've been telling you, Harvey is a rabbit. A big white rabbit, 6 feet high. Or is it 6 feet and a half? Heavens knows I ought to know. He's been around the house long enough.
Now, Mrs. Simmons, let me understand this.
Doctor, do I have to keep repeating myself? My brother insists that his closest friend is a big white rabbit. This rabbit is named Harvey. Harvey lives at our house. Don't you understand? He and El would go every place together. El would buy theater tickets and railroad tickets for both of them. As I told Myrtle May, if your uncle was so lonesome he had to bring something home, why couldn't he bring home something human? He has me, doesn't he? He has Myrtle May, doesn't he? Doctor, I'm going to tell you something I've never told anybody in the world before. Every once in a while, I see that big white rabbit myself. Now, isn't that terrible? I've never even told that to Myrtle May. And what's more, he's every bit as big as Elwood Sassy is. Now, don't ever tell that to anybody, Doctor. I'm ashamed of it.
Mrs. Simmons, you've been under a great deal of nervous strain lately.
Well, I certainly have.
Grief over your mother's death must have depressed you considerably.
Nobody knows how much.
Have you been losing sleep?
How could anybody sleep with that going on?
Short-tempered over trifles.
You just try living with those two. See how your temper holds up.
Have you been experiencing a loss of appetite?
No one could eat at the table with my brother and a big white rabbit. Well, I'm finished with it. I'll sell the house, be appointed conservator of Elwood's estate, and Myrtle May and I will be able to entertain our friends in peace. It's too much, Doctor. I just can't stand it.
Of course not, Mrs. Simmons. You're tired.
Yes, I am.
You've been under a great deal of stress lately.
I have. I can't help it.
And now I'm going to help you.
Oh, Doctor.
Just wait right there for one moment.
I'll just go down to the cab. Get over the thing.
Why didn't someone answer the buzzer?
I didn't hear you, Doctor.
I rang and rang. Mrs. Simmons? Sound the gong, Wilson. That poor woman must not leave the grounds.
She's made with a getaway, huh, Doc?
Yes, your condition is serious. Go after her. Main gate. Henry, Dr. Sanderson. Allow no one out of the main gate. We're looking for a patient. Why didn't someone answer the buzzer?
Wilson was in South, Doctor.
We need to contact her brother, Mrs. Simmons. Mrs. Simmons' brother, Elwood P. Dowd. Could you get him on the phone, please, Kelly?
But, Doctor, the woman said that the treatment was for her brother.
Of course she did. That's the oldest trick in the world. It's always used by the cunning type of psychopath. She apparently knew her brother was coming out here to commit her, so she came out to discredit him. Could you get him on the phone, please, Kelly?
But, Doctor, I thought that the woman was all right, so I had Wilson take the brother to room number 24, South Wing G. He's there now.
You did what? No gags, please, Kelly. You're not serious.
I did, Doctor. I'm terribly sorry.
Oh, well, then if you're sorry, that fixes everything.
I'll do it. Mrs. Dumphy, would you please unlock the door to number 24 and give Mr. Dowd his clothes and...
Ask him to step down to the office right away.
Ask him to step down to the office right away. There's been a terrible mistake, and Dr. Sanderson wants to explain.
Explain? Apologize.
Thank heavens they hadn't put him in the hydro tub yet. She'll let him out.
Beautiful. And dumb, too. It's almost too good to be true.
Doctor, I feel terrible. Judge Gaffney called out here and said Mrs. Simmons and her brother would be coming down, and when they came in... You don't have to be sarcastic.
Oh, don't I? Don't worry about it, Kelly. We'll scrum out of this somehow.
Where are you going?
I've got to talk to the chief about this. He may want to handle it himself.
He'll be furious. He'll die. And then he'll terminate me.
The responsibility is all mine, Kelly.
Oh, no. Tell him it was all my fault, Doctor.
I'll never mention your name, except in my sleep.
But this man, Dowd.
Keep him here, Kelly, no matter what.
But what shall I say to him? What shall I do? He'll be so angry.
Look, Kelly, he'll probably be fit to be tied, but he's a man, isn't he?
I guess so. His name is Mister.
Go into your old routine. You know, the eyes, the swish, the works. Keep him here, Kelly, if you have to do a striptease.
You're just wonderful, Dr. Sessions. You're just about the most wonderful person I ever met in my life.
Yeah, but how about giving me a hand here all the same?
What?
That's Simmons' dame.
Did you catch her?
Ugh, slick as a whistle. She was coming along the path outside, humming a little tune. I jumped out at her from behind the bush. I said, "Listen, lady, there's a doctor inside who wants to see you." You should have heard her scream. She's wacky, I tell you.
Take her to number 13, Upper West Star.
She's there now. I brought her in through the diet kitchen. I'll hold her if you'll undress her.
Just a minute, Wilson. Dr. Sanderson told me to stay right here until the brother comes down.
Yeah, we'll make it snappy.
You're Mr. Dow?
Ellen P.
I'm Miss Kelly.
Let me give you one of my cards. You should want to call me. Call me at that number, not at that one. That's the old one.
Thank you.
And don't worry, if you happen to lose it, I have plenty more.
Won't you have a seat, please, Mr. Dowd?
Thank you, I'll have two.
Dr. Sanderson is very anxious to speak with you. He'll be down in a minute. Please, have a seat.
After you.
I really can't, thank you. I'm in and out all the time, but you mustn't mind me. Please, sit down.
After you, I insist.
Could I get you a magazine to look at, Mr. Dowd?
Oh no, I'd really rather much look at you. You're really very pretty.
Well, thank you. Some people don't seem to think so.
Some people are blind. That is very often brought to my attention. And now, before we go any further, I must insist you let me introduce.
Mr. Dowd!
Ellen P.
I'm Dr. Lyman Sanderson, Dr. Tumley's assistant out here.
I'm happy to know that. How are you, Doctor?
Well, that's going to depend on you, I'm afraid. Please, have a seat.
Oh, after Miss Kelly.
Is that chair quite comfortable, Mr. Dowd?
Oh, yes. Would you care to try it?
No. But can I get you a mint? Should I open a window for you, Mr. Dowd? Is it too hot in here?
Mr. Dowd, Dr. Sanderson would like to know if you should open a window.
Well, that's entirely up to him. I wouldn't presume to live his life for him.
I can see you're not the type of man to be taken in by any high-flown phrases or beating around the bush, Mr. Dowd.
Is that so, Doctor?
Please sit down. People are people, no matter where you go.
That is very often the case.
And being human are therefore liable to make mistakes. Miss Kelly and I have made a mistake here this afternoon, and we'd like to explain it to you.
Very well.
You see, Mr. Dowd, it's not Miss Kelly's fault. She talked to your sister, and there had been a call from your family lawyer, Judge Gaffney.
Oh, yes. I know him. Know his wife.
Yes, your sister came in, and she went straight away into a heated tirade on your drinking.
That was better.
She became hysterical.
I'd feel better not to worry about that. I'll take care of it.
Of course. I suppose you take a drink now and then, the same as the rest of us?
Every once in a while. I do have a drink. As a matter of fact, I would like one right now, Doctor.
As a matter of fact, so would I. But your sister's reaction to the matter of drinking was entirely too intense. Does your sister drink, Mr. Dowd?
Oh, not, Doctor. I don't believe Ben has ever taken a drink.
Well, then, I'm going to surprise you. I believe she does, constantly.
I am certainly surprised.
But it's not your sister's alcoholism that's going to be the basis for my diagnosis of her case. It's something much more serious than that. It was when she began talking so passionately about a big white rabbit, Harvey. I believe she called him Harvey.
Harvey is his name.
She claimed you were persecuting her with this, Harvey.
I haven't been persecuting Vetta with Harvey. Vetta shouldn't feel that way. And now, Doctor, before we go any further, I must insist you let me introduce.
Oh, later on, I'd be glad to. But let me make my point first, Mr. Dowd. Your sister's condition did not spring up overnight. It stems from trauma.
From what?
From trauma, spelled T-R-A-U-M-A. It means shock. There's nothing unusual about it. There is the birth trauma. The shock to the act of being born?
That's what we never get over.
You have a nice sense of humor, Mr. Dash. Doesn't he, Miss Kelly?
Yes, Doctor.
May I say the same for both of you?
To sum it all up, your sister's condition is serious, but we can help her. She must, however, remain out here temporarily.
I've always felt better she'd have everything she needs.
Exactly.
But I wouldn't want better to stay out here unless she wanted to stay out here and liked it out here.
Of course. Did Wilson get what he went after, Miss Kelly?
Yes, Doctor.
And what was Mrs. Simmons' reaction?
Not unusual, Doctor.
Ha. Now, Mr. Dowd, if this were an ordinary delusion, that is, something that were based on a memory picture, something she had seen before, that would be one thing. But it stands to reason that no one has ever seen a white rabbit 6 feet high.
Not very often, Doctor.
I like you, Dad.
I like you, too. And Miss Kelly here. I like her, too.
So you see, your sister must be committed out here temporarily. Under these same conditions, I would commit my own grandma.
Does your grandmother drink, too?
No, it's just an expression. Now, will you sign these temporary commitment forms?
Oh, you better have better do that, Doctor. She does all the signing and managing for our family. She's good at it.
Oh, well, we can't disturb Veta right now.
Perhaps I better call Judge Gaffney.
You can talk it all over with him later. Tell him I advise you. And it isn't as if you couldn't come down here and check on Veta anytime you wanted to. When would you like to come back? I'll make a full visitor's pass for you. Wednesday? Friday?
Well, the two of you have been so kind, I can come back for it after dinner.
Oh, well, I guess that's all right.
I don't really have to go right now. I'm not very hungry.
Well, Miss Kelly and I are very busy right now, but I tell you what you might like to do.
What might I like to do?
Just to make sure in your mind that your sister is in good hands, why don't you take a look around? If you go out that door, on the left, there's the diet kitchen, and beyond that, the conservatory and the library.
For better sake, I believe I better do that, Doctor.
Very well, Mr. Dad. I've enjoyed having this little talk with you.
I've enjoyed it, too. Meeting you and Miss Kelly here.
And may I say that for a layman, you show an unusually acute perception of psychiatric problems.
Is that so, Doctor? I didn't know I knew anything about them. Nobody does, do you think?
Well, the good psychiatrist isn't found under every bush.
You have to pick the right bush. Since we all seem to be enjoying this, so let's keep right on. I would like to invite the two of you to come down with me to Charlie's place to have a drink.
Oh, well, we're on duty right now, Mr. Dad. Some other time we'd be glad to.
Well, what? When would you be glad to?
We don't usually get off until 10 o'clock at night.
10 o'clock tonight it is, then. And you, Miss Kelly?
I really don't.
Very well. I'll pick the two of you up in a cab at 10 o'clock tonight. I want the two of you to become good friends with a dear friend of mine. You said later on, so later on it'll be. Goodbye now.
Goodbye.
Now I can breathe again.
Boy, that was a close shave, all right. But he seemed a pretty reasonable sort of fellow. That man was proud, Kelly. What he had to be proud of, I don't know. But I played up to that pride. You can get almost anyone if you want to.
Dr. Sanderson, you say you can get to almost anybody if you want to. How can you do that?
It takes years of practice, Kelly. Years of specialized training. There's just one thing I don't like about this Dowd business, though.
What's that?
Having to make a date with him. I mean, I guess I'll have to go, because he left as a good friend and a booster of this sanitarium, but you don't have to go, Kelly.
Oh.
No point in it. I'll go, have a drink with him, pat him on the back, and leave. I've got a date tonight anyway.
Oh, yes. By all means. I didn't intend to go anyways. The idea bored me stiff. I wouldn't go if I never went anywhere again. I wouldn't go if my life depended on it.
What are you getting so emotional about, Kelly?
He may be a peculiar man with funny clothes, but his manners were perfect.
I saw you give him that doll puss stare. I didn't miss that.
He wouldn't sit down till I sat down. He told me I was lovely, and he called me dear. I'd go have a drink with him if you weren't going.
All he does is drink. He doesn't work. All that phony jumping out of his chair every time a woman makes a move, Why, he's as outdated as a cast iron deer. But you go and sit with him and have a drink in a bar. You're wonderful, Kelly.
Let me tell you something, Dr. Sanderson. I can't.
Dr. Sanderson.
Dr. Chumley.
Tell the gardener to prune more carefully around my prize dahlias along the fence by the main road. They'll be ready for cutting next week. And the one with the overgrown white rabbit, has it been smoothed over?
Yes, doctor. Her brother was quite reasonable.
While I've had many patients in my day with animals, I've never before had a patient with an animal this large.
She called him Harvey.
Harvey. Unusual name for an animal. Harvey's a man's name. I have known several men in my day named Harvey. Harvey's a peculiar name for any animal of any kind. This case has an interesting phase, doctor.
Yes, doctor.
Come with me now upstairs. I won't look in on this woman. Perhaps we can use Marfola 977 on her. I'll give you my advice and prescribe the treatment.
Thank you, doctor.
And now, I ask, what is that hat and coat doing on that table? Whose is it?
I don't know. Did Dad leave it here, Kelly?
He had his hat on when he left. Perhaps it belongs to a relative of one of the patients?
Hand me that hat. Perhaps it's some kind of identification in it. What's this? Two holes cut into the crown, see?
That's strange.
Some new fat. Hang them up. Put them away. Get him out of here.
Hello, Dr. Chumley.
Oh, there you are.
How is every little old thing?
Fair. Thank you, Wilson. Fair.
Look, somebody is going to have to do something about this Simmons dame. She is terrible. Order a restraining harness or something. Hey, forgot me, didn't you? Well, I got her course off all by myself.
We're going upstairs to look in on this woman now, Wilson.
Oh, she's up in the hydro tub now. My God, I left the water running on her.
Right. I have to go upstairs and look in on a patient. Be down shortly.
We'll make a little quick diagnosis. We don't want to be late to the party. I'm dying to see the inside of that house. Oh, good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Mrs. Chumley, Dr. Chumley's wife.
I'm having another. That is my name. Edward P. Let me give you one of my cards. You should want to call me. Call me that number. Not that one. That's the old one.
Thank you. Is there something I can do for you?
What do you have in mind?
Well, you seem to be looking for someone.
Oh, yes. I'm looking for Harvey.
Harvey. Is he a patient here?
Oh, no. Nothing like that. He's what you... what you might call my best friend.
Well, does he work here?
Oh, no. He's a puka.
Well, where was he when you last saw him?
Sitting right there, with his hat and coat on the table.
Well, there doesn't appear to be any hat or coat around here now. Perhaps he left?
Apparently. I don't see him anywhere.
Well, what was that word you just used? A puka?
Oh, yes, that's it.
Is that something new?
Oh, no. As I understand it, it's something very old.
Oh, really? Well, I've never happened to hear that before.
That doesn't surprise me. I hadn't happened to hear it myself until I met him. Mrs. Chumley, I do hope he has the pleasure of meeting you. I believe he'd be quite taken with you.
Oh, really? Well, that's very nice of you to say, I'm sure.
Not at all. If Harvey happens to take a liking to someone, he expresses himself quite definitely. If not, he just kind of sits there like an empty space on the floor, an empty chair. Choosy, you see.
That's not such a bad way to be this day and age.
So Harvey is fond of my sister Venom. That's because he's fond of me. And Venom and I come from the same family. Now you'd think that feeling would be mutual, wouldn't you? But Venom doesn't seem to care for Harvey. That's a bit too bad, isn't it, Mrs. Shumway?
Oh, I don't know, Mr. Dowd. I've given up a long time ago trying to get my family to like my friends. It's useless.
Well, he must keep trying.
Well, there's no harm in trying, I suppose.
Because if Harvey said it to me once, he said it to me 1,000 times. Mr. Dowd, I would do anything for you. Mrs. Chumley.
Yes?
Do you know that
Mrs. McElhenney's Aunt Rose is coming in unexpectedly tonight from Cleveland?
Why, no, I didn't.
Neither did she. That puts you two in rather the same boat.
Well, I don't know anybody named Mrs.
Mrs. McElhenney? Lives next door to us. Wonderful person. Harvey told me about her Aunt Rose. That's an interesting little news item. Feel free to pass it around.
Will I,
Mrs. Shumway?
Yes?
Is it possible for you to come down with me to have a drink?
Oh, thank you, but I really couldn't. I'm waiting on Dr. Chumley. If he came down here and found me gone, he would be liable to raise he would be irritated.
Well, we wouldn't want that, would we? Some other time, perhaps.
I'll tell you what I'll do, however.
What will you do, however? I'm interested.
If your friend comes in here while I'm still here, I would be glad to give him a message from you.
Would you do that? I would certainly appreciate it.
Oh, no trouble at all. I'll write it down on the back of his card. Now, if he comes in here while I'm still here, what would you like me to tell him from you?
Tell him to meet me downtown.
Meet Mr. Dowd downtown. Any particular place downtown?
Harvey knows where. He knows this town like a book.
Harvey, you know where. Harvey what?
Just Harvey.
I'll tell you what.
What?
Doctor and I are going right downtown to 12th and Montview. Dr. McClure is having a cocktail party.
A cocktail party at 12th and Montview?
We're driving there in a few minutes. We could give your friend a lift into town.
Would you do that? I wouldn't want you to go out of your way.
Oh, no trouble at all. Dr. McClure is having a cocktail party for his sister from Wichita.
I didn't know Dr. McClure had a sister in Wichita.
Oh, you know Dr. McClure?
No.
Oh, but you...
Are you sure you can't come down with a drink?
Thank you, but I really couldn't.
Some other time. But a pleasure having this little chat with you, Mrs. Shumway.
Yes, definitely.
Good night, my dear.
Good night.
Oh, and you can't miss Harvey. He's like this. Goodbye now. This Simmons woman is uncooperative, Doctor. She refuses to admit to me that she has overgrown white rabbit. So give her two of these at 9, another one at 10. She continues to be so restless, I show up to the hydrogen at 7, another one at 8 in the morning. Then we'll see who's uncooperative, won't we, Doctor?
Yes, Doctor.
You know where to call me if you need me. Ready, Pat?
Yes, Willie. And, oh, Willie.
Yes?
There was a man here. A man named... Oh, here's his card. Let's see. Dowd. Elwood P. Dowd.
Oh, that's Mrs. Simmons' brother, Doctor.
She must not see anyone tonight. Not anyone at all. Tell him that.
Yes?
He didn't ask to see her. He was looking for someone, some friend of his.
Who could that be, Dr. Sanderson?
I don't know, Doctor. Was Dowd with anyone, Miss Kay?
Not when I saw him.
Well, he said there was. He said he last saw his friend sitting right there in that chair with his hat and coat on the table. He seemed quite disappointed. I told him if we located his friend, we could give him a lift into town. He could ride in the back seat. Was that okay, Willie?
Of course, of course.
His friend's name was... Oh, right here on the back of the cart. Harvey. His friend's name was Harvey.
Harvey.
He didn't give me any last name, but he mentioned something about...
Harvey.
I didn't quite get what that was. And he said his friend was very tall, like this, and... Well, why are you looking like that, Willie? This was a very nice... Very polite man, and he merely asked that we give his friend a lift into town. Well, if we can't do a favor for someone, then why are we living?
Where did he go? How long ago was it?
Oh, I don't know. Just a minute ago.
Give me that hat. By George, I'll find out about this.
Main gate. Henry, it's Dr. Sanderson. Has a man in a gray suit left? He did? He's gone.
Judge Gaffney, this is Dr. William Chumley, the psychiatrist. I'm doing a routine checkup on the spelling of a patient of ours before we put him into our records. Today, you telephoned out here about having a client of yours committed. How is that name spelled? With a W, not a U? Mr. Elwood P. Dowd? Thank you. Dr. Sanderson, I believe your name is Sanderson.
Yes, Doctor.
You know that much, do you? You yes. Want to... Medical school, you
specialized in the study of psychiatry. You graduated, you went forth. Perhaps they neglected to tell you that a rabbit has large pointed ears! That a hat for a rabbit has to be prepared to make room for those ears?
Mr. Dowd seemed quite reasonable this afternoon, Doctor.
Doctor! The function of a psychiatrist is to tell the difference between those who are reasonable and those who merely act and talk reasonably. Do you know what you've done to me? Don't answer! I'll tell you. You have permitted a psychopathic case to walk off these grounds with an overgrown white rabbit. You have subjected me, a psychiatrist, to call, of all things, a lawyer to see who's come out here to be committed and who's come out here to commit.
Dr. Shumley,
just a minute, Wilson, I want you. I will now have to do something I have not done in 15 years. I will have to go out after this patient, LVP down, and bring him back here. And when I do, your connection to this institution ends as of that moment. Wilson, get the car. Pat, call the clerks and tell them we can't make it. Nurse Kelly, come with me. We need that woman at the Hyde Hotel.
Yes, doctor.
Great. I'll have to tell the cook we'll be home for supper. She will be furious. Hey, Wilson.
Yes, ma'am.
What's a puka?
A what?
A puka.
You can search me, ma'am.
I wonder if it'd be over here in the dictionary. The dictionary is everything. If it's a lodge or what it is. I dare not stop to do this now. If Dr. Chumley comes down here and finds me still here, he will be liable to raise he would be, oh dear.
Puka. P. P. O. O. K. A. Puka. From old Celtic mythology. A fairy spirit in animal form. Always very large. The puka appears here and there, now and then, to this one and that one at his own caprice. A wise but mischievous creature. Very fond of rum pots, crackpots, and how are you, Mr. Wilson? How are you, Mr. Wilson? Who in the dictionary wants to know? Ah, to hell with it.
She took Uncle Elwood out to the sanitarium.
I know that, but why was I caught at the sanitarium, at the club, I mean, with a lot of hysteria? Couldn't even get what she was talking about. Carrying on with something fierce?
Mother carrying on? What about?
I don't know. She was hysterical.
That's strange. All she had to do was take Uncle Elwood out to the sanitarium and put him in. Did you find it? They found it.
Who? Found what? What are you talking about?
Well, when Mother left for Chumley's Rest, I went to the real estate office, and whom do you think I found there?
I'm not a quiz kid.
Well, I found a man there who wanted a big house just like this one to cut open into buffet apartments.
Now, see here, Myrtle May, this house doesn't belong to you. It belongs to your Uncle Elwood.
But now that Uncle Elwood is locked up, Mother controls the property, doesn't she?
Where is your mother? Where's Betta Louise?
Judge Gaffney, I told you. She went over to Chumley's Rest to tell them about Harvey and put Uncle Elwood in.
Well, why did she call me at the club when I was in the middle of a game and scream at me to meet her here about something important?
I don't know. I simply don't know. Have you got the deed to this house?
Certainly. It's in my safe. Myrtle, I feel pretty bad about this thing of locking Elwood up.
Mother and I will be able to take a long trip now out to Pasadena.
I always liked that boy. He could have done anything, been anything, made a place for himself in this community.
And all he did was get a big rabbit.
He had everything. Brains, personality, friends. Men liked him, women liked him, I liked him.
Do you mean to tell me that women actually liked Uncle Elwood? I mean in that sort of way.
Not since he started running around with that big white rabbit. But they did once. Once that mailbox of your grandmother's was full of those little blue scented envelopes for Elwood.
I don't believe it.
Yes, there was always something different about Elwood.
I don't doubt that.
Yes, he did always take any sudden change in plans calmly. I used to admire it, but I should have been suspicious. Take your average man, looking up, seeing a big white rabbit, he'd do something about it.
But not Elwood. He took that calmly, too, and look where it got him.
You don't dream how far overboard Uncle Elwood's gone on this rabbit.
Oh, yes, I do. He's had that rabbit in my office many of the time. I'm old, but I don't miss much. What's that noise?
The prospective buyer on the third floor. Mother! Look, Judge!
But Louise, what's wrong, girl?
I never thought I'd see either of you again!
Take a hold of her, Judge. I think she's gonna faint. Mother, you're gonna be all right. You're gonna be perfectly all right.
Steady. Steady, girl. Steady.
Please, not so fast!
Don't rush her, Myrtle. Ease her in.
Let me sit down. Only get me someplace where I can sit down.
Oh.
Here you are, girl.
The gas bill.
Oh. Myrtle, get Betta some tea, won't you?
I'll get you some tea, Mother. Get her coat off, Judge.
Let Myrtle get your coat off, Betta. Myrtle, get her coat off.
Leave me alone! Let me sit here! Let me get my breath!
Let her catch your breath, Judge.
Let me sit here a minute, and then let me get upstairs to my own bed where I can let go.
Mother, what happened to you?
Homer, I want you to sue them! They put me in and let Elwood out!
What's this?
Mother!
Just look at my hair!
But what did you say? What did you do? You must have done something.
I didn't do one thing. I simply told them about Elwood and Harvey.
Then how could this happen to you? I don't understand it.
I told them about Elwood, and then I went down to the cab to get his things. As I was walking along the path, this awful man stepped out. He was a white slaver. I know he was. He had on one of those white suits. That's how they advertise.
A man. What did he do, Mother?
What did he do? He took hold of me, and he took me in there, and then he...
Go on, Vita Louise. Go on, girl.
Poor Mother. Was he a young man?
Myrtle May, perhaps you better leave the room.
Leave the room? I should say not. Go on, Mother.
What did he do, Vita?
He took me upstairs and tore my clothes off.
Did you hear that, Judge? Go on.
God, I'll sue them for this.
And then he sat me down in a tub of water.
For heaven's sake.
I always thought that what you were showed on your face. Don't you believe it, Judge? Don't you believe it, Myrtle? This man took hold of me like I was a woman of the streets. But I thought. I always said that if a man jumped down at me, I'd fight. Haven't I always said that, Myrtle?
She's always said that, Judge. That's what Mother told me what to do.
And then he hustled me into that sanitarium and set me down in that tub of water and began treating me like I was a...
A what?
A crazy woman! But he did that just for spite.
Well, I'll be damned.
And those doctors came upstairs and asked me a lot of questions, all about sex urges and all that filthy stuff. That place ought to be cleaned up, Omar. You'd better get the authorities in there to clean it up. Myrtle, don't you ever go out there, you hear me?
This stinks to high heaven, Vela. By God, it stinks.
You've got to do something about it, Judge. You've got to sue them.
I will, girl. By God, I will. If Chumley thinks he can run an unsavory place like this on the outskirts of town, he'll be publicly chastised. By God, I'll run him out of the state.
Tell me, Judge, is that all those doctors do at places like that? Think about sex?
I don't know.
Because if it is, they ought to be ashamed of themselves. It's all in their head anyway. Why don't they get out and go for long walks in the fresh air? Judge Gaffney walked everywhere for years, didn't you, Judge?
Now, let me take some notes on this. You said these two doctors came up to talk to you. Dr. Chumley and, what was the other doctor's name?
Dr. Sanderson. But, Judge, don't you pay any attention to anything he tells you. He's a liar. Close-set eyes. They're always liars. Besides, I told him something in the strictest confidence, and he blabbed it.
Oh, what did you tell him, Mother?
Oh, what difference does it make? Let's forget it. I don't even want to talk about it. You can't trust anybody.
Now, Vita Louise, anything you told this Dr. Sanderson, you can tell us. This is your daughter, and I am a lawyer.
I know which is which, and I don't want to talk about it. I want to sue them, and I want to get to my own bed.
Now, Mother, no matter who jumped you out there, we have to know this. Where is Uncle Elwood?
How should I know? They let him go. They're not interested in men in places like that. Don't act so naive, Myrtle May. What's that noise?
I found a buyer for the house.
What?
Mother. See, the thing is, we gotta find Uncle Elwood.
I don't know where he is. The next time you take him, Judge, wait until Elwood hears what they did to me. He won't stand for it.
Don't forget to sue them, Judge. Myrtle May, all I hope is that never, never as long as you live, a man pulls the clothes off you and dumps you down into a tub of water.
Now see, Mother's muffed everything. No matter who jumped her out there, Uncle Elwood is still out on the loose with that Harvey.
The thing for me to do is take some more notes.
It's all Uncle Elwood's fault. He found out what she was going to do, he had her put in, and then he ran.
Oh, no, don't talk like that. Your uncle thinks the world and all of your mother. Ever since he was a little boy, he always wanted to share everything he had with her.
I'm not giving up. I'll get detectives. We'll find him. And besides, you better save some of that sympathy for me and Mother. Wait till I show you what Uncle Elwood brought home 6 months ago and we hid in the garage. You just wait, Judge.
I'm going up to talk to Veda. There's more of this than she's telling. I sense that.
Wait till I show you, Judge.
All right, I'll wait.
Okay, is he here?
What? What's this?
That nut with the rabbit. Is he here?
No. And whom, may I ask, are you?
Not here, Doctor. Well, Dr. Chumley's coming in anyway. Now, what's your name?
Chumley. Well, well, well. If I got something to say to him.
What's your name? Out with it.
I am Judge Omar Gaffney. Where's Chumley?
The reason I ask your name is the doctor always wants to know who he's speaking to. Doctor, this man says his name is, Judge Omar Gaffney.
Chumley. Well, well.
Evening, Judge. Let's not waste time. Has he been here?
Who? Oh, Elwood. No, but see here, Doctor.
Are you sure? He's a sly one. It'll be a job to smoke him out.
It'll be more difficult, but I'll do it. They're sly. They're cunning. But I get them. I always get them. Do you have the list of places we've been, Wilson?
Right here, Doctor.
Read it.
Let's see. We've been to 17 bars. Eddie's Place, Charlie's Place, Bessie's Barn Dance, the 4th Avenue Firehouse, the 10th, 12th, and 9th Avenue Firehouses, just to be sure, the Union Station, the Grain Elevator. Say, why does this guy go to a grain elevator anyway?
The foreman is a friend of his. He has many friends in many places.
Now, I've come by to ask Mrs. Simmons if she knows of any other places where we might be able to look for this man.
Dr. Chumley, I have to inform you that Mrs. Simmons has her team made a false suit against you.
What?
For what happened to her at the sanitarium this afternoon.
A suit?
And while we're on that subject...
That's nice, ain't it, Doctor? After us dragging your tail all over town looking for this guy, now this.
Listen, what happened this afternoon was an unfortunate mistake. I discharged my assistant who made it. I am prepared to take charge of this man's case personally. It interests me, Judge, and my interest in the case is something no amount of money can buy. You can ask any of them.
But this business this afternoon, Doctor.
Water under the dam. This is how I see this. The task now in hand is to find this man and bring him back out to the sanitarium where he belongs.
That's right, Judge. That's exactly what I think.
Let me introduce to you Miss Myrtle May Simmons, Mr. Dowd's niece, Mrs. Simmons' daughter.
How do you do, Dr. Chumley?
How do you do, Miss Simmons?
Hello, Myrtle.
Hello.
Now then, let me talk to Mrs. Simmons.
She won't come down, Doctor. You try to get her down, Judge.
But see here, Myrtle. Your mother was manhandled. She was... God knows what she was. The man's approach to her was not professional. It was personal.
Wilson, this is a serious charge.
Doctor, I've been with you for 10 years. Who are you gonna believe? Me or this... What's your name again?
Gaffney. Judge Omar Gaffney.
Who are you going to believe? Me or this old blister?
Wilson!
Me and this dame who sees a rabbit.
It's not Mrs. Simmons who sees a rabbit. It's her brother.
Yeah, it's Uncle Elwood.
If you'll come with me, Doctor.
Very well. Wilson, I have a situation here. Wait for me.
So, your name's Myrtle May.
Yes.
You know, if we catch your uncle, you're likely to be down to the sanitarium on visiting days.
Well, I don't know. I...
Well, if you do come down, you know, I'll be there.
You will? Oh.
And if you don't see me at first, you know, wait around. I'll show up.
You will? Oh.
Now, you heard the doctor ask me to wait, right?
Yes.
Well, you know, while I'm waiting, I sure could use a cup of coffee and a sandwich.
Well, if you'll forgive me, I'll precede you to the kitchen.
Yes, sir, Myrtle. You're all right.
What?
Doctor saw him right away. He don't miss a tick. Tell you something else, Myrtle.
What?
Not only do you got a nice build, but you've got something else.
What?
got the screwiest uncle who ever stuck his mug in our nut house.
Hello, Chumley's Rust. It's Adam Chumley there. Oh, it's Mrs. Chumley. How are you? Tell me, Mrs. Chumley, were you able to locate Harvey? Oh, that's all right. I'll find him. I left you at the McClure party. I waited until you phoned and said a patient had escaped. The people were all very nice there. Yes, I was able to leave quite a few of my cards. Oh, where am I? I'm here, but I'm leaving right away. I have to find Harvey. Yes, goodbye, Mrs. Chumley. Bye.
Of your mantle.
This portrait happens to be the pride of this house.
Who painted it?
Oh, some man. I forget his name. He was around here for the sittings, and we paid him, and he went away. Hello? Yes. No, this is Dexter 1567.
I suppose if you have the money, you can persuade people to do just about anything.
Well, Dr. Chumley, when you helped me out that tub in your place, what did I say to you?
You expressed yourself. I don't quite remember the words.
I said, Dr. Chumley, this is belated civility. Isn't that what I said?
You said something of that sort.
You brought this up. You may as well learn something quick. The difference between a fine oil painting and a mechanical thing like a photograph is simply this. A photograph shows only the reality. A painting shows not only the reality, but the dream behind it. It's our dreams that keep us going, that separates us from the beasts. I wouldn't even want to live if I thought it was all just eating and sleeping and taking off my clothes. Well, putting them on again. Ah! Oh, doctor!
Calm down. What's the matter?
Doctor, that is not my mother!
I'm glad to hear that.
Doctor! Edward's been here! He's been here!
Better be quiet. I'll take it. Hello? Yes. Mrs. Simmons, it's your brother.
Oh, let me talk to him.
Don't let him know I'm here. Be casual.
Hello, Edward? Where are you? Oh, just a minute. He won't say where he is. He wants to know if Harvey is here.
Tell him Harvey is here.
But he isn't.
Tell him he is. Humor him. We have to humor them.
Yes, Elwood.
Yes, dear, Harvey is here. Why don't you come home? Oh. Oh, well, all right. It won't work! He says for Harvey to come to the telephone.
Tell him Harvey's here, but he can't come to the phone.
Tell him...
he's in the bathtub.
Bathtub?
Tell him he's in the bathtub, and just send him over as soon as he gets out. That way we'll find out where he is.
Oh, doctor.
Now you've got to do it, Mrs. Simmons.
Yes, Edward, Harvey is here, but he can't come to the telephone right now. He's in the bathtub. I'll send him over as soon as he's dry. Where are you, Edward? Where, Edward?
Did he hang up?
Harvey just walked in the door. He said to check in the bathtub. It must be a stranger. But I know where he is. He's at Harvey's place. That's the bar over at 12th and Main.
12th and Main. That's two blocks over, one down, isn't it?
Doctor, where are you going?
I'm going to get your brother and bring him back out to the sanitarium where he belongs.
Oh, Dr. Chumley, don't do that. Send one of your attendants. I'm warning you.
Do you consider your brother a dangerous man?
Dangerous?
Why?
I won't tell you why, but if I didn't, why would I be asking for a permanent commitment for him?
Then I must observe him. I must watch him as he talks to this rabbit. He does talk to him, you say?
Harvey tells Edward everything.
What's that?
I said of course he talks to him, but don't go after him, Doctor. You'll regret it if you do.
Nonsense. You underestimate me, Mr. Simmons.
You underestimate my brother.
Don't worry now. I can handle him.
You can handle him? That's what you think. Myrtle May, see who's in the bathtub. Oh.
I may call later.
Kelly?
Doctor, how about the stuff in your room, upstairs?
Oh, I'll pack, thanks, Wilson.
Look, Doctor, I'm sorry you got the boot. I had you pegged for one who made you great.
Well, those are the bricks.
When you head now?
As soon as Dr. Chummy gets back.
Kelly, did you hear back from the desk sergeant at the Police Accident Bureau yet?
Not yet. I just talked to the downtown dispensary and they haven't seen him.
That's odd. 4 hours, not a word.
Well, Doctor, I may not see you again, so I just want to wish you a lot of luck, and I'm sorry you got the boot.
Well, thanks, Wilson. I'd like to wish you good luck, too.
Kelly, make sure to tell me when the sergeant calls. If the doctor don't call back soon, I'm going to go after him. He should know better than to go after a psycho without me.
I'd like to help look for the doctor, too, Wilson.
Oh, that's mighty swell of you, after he gave you the brush and all.
Oh, I have no resentments against Dr. Chumley. He was right and I was wrong. Chumley is the biggest man in his field, and it's my loss not to be able to work with him.
Well, you're not so small yourself, Doctor.
Oh, thanks, Wilson.
Don't mention it.
Dr. Sanderson.
Yes?
I'd like to say that I wish you a lot of luck, too, and I'm sorry to see you go.
Well, are you sure you can spare those good wishes, Miss Kelly?
On second thought, I guess I can't.
Look, Kelly, this is for nothing, just a bit of advice. But I'd be careful about the kind of company I kept if I were you.
I beg your pardon, Doctor?
Well, I saw you dancing with that drip down in the Rose Room Hotel in the Frontier.
Oh, did you? I didn't notice you.
I'd be careful if I were you, Kelly. You look like a schizophrenic all the way across the floor.
I wouldn't worry about him if I were you, Doctor. He was my date, not yours.
Well, that was his mentality, too.
But she was beautiful, though.
Who?
That girl you were with.
Well, I thought you didn't notice.
How could I help it? You bumped into us twice.
Not that it's of any concern to you, Kelly, but that girl is a charming young lady. She has a sweet kind of disposition, and she knows how to conduct herself.
Funny she couldn't rate a better date on a Saturday night.
And she has an excellent mind, too.
Why doesn't she use it?
I don't suppose you're to be censored for the hard, flippant shell you have on, Kelly. You're probably compensating for something.
I am not, and don't you use any of your psychiatry on me.
Oh, if I could try something else, just once, just to see if you melt under any circumstances. I doubt it.
You'll never know, Doctor.
It's because you interest me as a case history, that's all. I'd like to know where you get that inflated ego of yours.
If you aren't the meanest person, inflated ego, case history?
Come back here, let's finish this. Back.
Chumley's rest. Yes, Sergeant. No accident report on him in either town or suburbs? Look, Sergeant, maybe we better... Never mind, they're here now. Mr. Dowd.
Miss Kelly, these are for you.
Thank you.
They're quite fresh, too. I just picked them outside.
Did Dr. Chumley see you? They're his prized dahlias. Did he go upstairs?
I don't know. These clothes look lovely against your hair.
I've never worn burnt orange, such a trying color.
You would improve any color, my dear.
Thank you. Did Dr. Chumley go to his house?
I don't know. Where is Dr. Sanderson?
Over in his office, I think.
Dr. Sanderson?
Dad, there you are.
I have a cow outside of the hospital. You and Miss Kelly are away now.
Well, where's Dr. Chumley?
Is he coming with us? That's nice.
Well, just a minute, Dad. The situation has changed a bit since you were here this afternoon. But I urge you to have no resentments against Dr. Chumley. He only wants to help you.
That's nice of him. I'd like to help him, too.
Good. If you begin by taking a cooperative attitude, that's half the battle. You know, we all have to face reality sometime, Mr. Dowd.
Doctor, I've wrestled with reality for 40 years. I'm happy to say I finally went over it.
Oh, there you are. Come on, buddy. We're going upstairs. Oh. Is the doctor okay?
There must be some mistake. Dr. Sanders and Miss Kelly and I are going to Charlie's to have a drink. I'd be happy to have you join us, Mr.
Wilson.
Wilson, they have a wonderful floor show.
Yes, well, we've got a wonderful floor show here too, buddy. Come on, upstairs.
Just a minute, Wilson. Where do you say Dr. Chumley is, Mr. Dad?
Well, he came into Charlie's earlier.
You mean he ain't showed up yet?
Not yet.
Well, where is he?
That's what we're trying to find out.
Mr. Dowd walked in here by himself.
Oh, he did, eh? Listen, you. Talk faster, I'm working you over.
I'd rather not do that. I'd rather not even mention such a thing in the presence of a young lady such as Miss Kelly.
Mr. Dowd, where is Dr. Chumley?
I don't know.
Nothing?
Well, he did come into Charlie's earlier. I was happy to see him. He asked for me, and after the pride had brought him over to me, and left.
Go on.
Well, after he came over, we started talking. We exchanged conventional greetings. I said, "How do you do, Dr. Chumley?" And he said, "How are you, Mr. Dowd?" I believe we said that at least once.
Okay.
I then introduced him to Harvey.
To who?
A white rabbit, 6 feet tall.
6 feet?
61 and a half.
That's it. Fool around with this guy while the doctor's probably lying in some ditch somewhere, bleeding to death.
If those were his plans, he didn't confide in me.
Go on, Mr. Dowd.
Well, I then introduced Dr. Chumley to Harvey. And so then he sat down. I was seated on the outside with Harvey on the inside, across from Dr. Chumley, where he could see him.
Yeah, that's it. Spend all money on the seating arrangements.
I'm trying to be factual, Mr. Wilson. Harvey then suggested that I buy him a drink. And knowing that he was not willing to drink alone, I suggested that Dr. Chumley and I join him.
And so?
We joined him.
Go on.
Well, then we joined him again.
And after that?
We kept right on joining him.
Okay, skip all the joining.
Mr. Wilson, you're asking me to skip a large portion of the evening.
Look, just tell us where the doctor is. Come on, please.
Well, then... Let me think. Hmm. Dr. Chumley had a small debate with Harvey. Harvey believed that Dr. Chumley should take responsibility for the financially for the joining.
I can believe that's part of it.
Dr. Chumley did not like that very much. Well, during the arguing, I decided to take it all because I didn't want any trouble. We got on to Charlie's a lot, Harvey and I, and the proprietor is a fine man with a wonderful outlook on life.
Okay. Quit the damn double talk and get on with it!
Mr. Wilson, you are a sincere dead person, but I must ask you not to use such language in front of Miss Kelly. Anyway, and then the other matter, Pop.
Mr. Dunn, the other matter?
Well, there was a beautiful woman, a Mrs. Smethels, I believe, seated across from us with our escort. Dr. Chumley sat next to her and explained that they had met somewhere, in Chicago, I believe. Her escort immediately escorted Dr. Chumley back to us and said that he should stick to his own affairs. Does he have any?
Any what?
Any affairs.
How would I know?
Please hurry, Mr. Dad. We're all so worried.
Later that evening, Dr. Chumley and Harvey got into another debate. Harvey wanted to go to Eddie's bar, I believe. And Dr. Chumley had wanted him to go to Blondie's Chicken. During the arguing, I went up to the bar and ordered another drink. When I turned around and came back, they were gone.
So where did they go? I mean, where did the doctor go?
As I said, I don't know. I had a date with Dr. Sanderson and Miss Kelly. I was hoping that we'd run into Dr. Chumley and Harvey and make a party out of it.
Okay. We've heard his story. Now I know you're lying!
Mr. Wilson, I never lie.
You've done something with the doctor, and I am finding out what it is.
Don't touch him, Wilson.
Maybe he isn't lying, Wilson.
That's all this guy is. A bunch of lies. You don't believe his story about the doctor talking to some big rabbit, do you?
Maybe Mr. Chumley did go down to Charlie's place.
And had a conversation with a big rabbit, I suppose.
And why not? Harvey was there. At first, Dr. Chumley seemed a bit frightened of Harvey. But that wore away to admiration as the evening wore on. Say, that's a nice phrase. And with your permission, I'll say it again. The evening wore on.
And with your permission, I'm gonna knock the teeth down your throat.
Excuse me. Mr. Wilson, don't you have any old friends you can play with?
The nerve of this guy. He couldn't come down here with a normal case of DTs. He came down here with a big white rabbit.
Oh, I really must be going. I have things to do.
Charlie's place. Has Dr. Chumley been down there? He was there earlier this evening with Mr. Dowd. Well, don't bite my head off. That man was mean. He said you were welcome any time, but Dr. Chumley was not.
That would be Mr. McNulty, the bartender. He thinks a lot of me. Now, why don't we go on to Charlie's and have a drink?
Mr. Dowd.
Yes, my dear. May I hold your hand?
Yes, if you want to. Mr. Dowd, Mrs. Chumley is so worried. If you know anything that could help us find the doctor, anything at all.
For you, I'd be willing to do almost anything. I'd almost even be willing to live my life over again. Almost. But I've told it all.
You're sure?
Yes, but ask me again. I like that warm tone in your voice just now.
So did I.
Ah, nuts.
What?
Nuts.
Oh, I must be going. I have things to do.
Mr. Dowd, what is it you do?
Well, me and Harvey, we go to the bars. We sip, we have a drink. Soon people come up to us. They say, "We don't know you, mister, but you're a lovely fellow." Harvey and I warm ourselves in these golden moments. We've entered as strangers, simply well of friends. They sit with us. They talk to us. They tell us all the horrible things they've done, all the wonderful things they will do. Their hopes, their dreams, their loves, their hates. All quite large, because no one ever comes into a bar with anything small. And then I introduce him to Harvey, and he is bigger and grander than anything they can ever offer me. When they leave impressed. The same people seldom come back. That's the envy, my dear. There's a little bit of envy in everyone.
Mr. Dad, how did you happen to call him Harvey?
Harvey is his name.
Perhaps, but how did you know that?
Well, that's an interesting little coincidence. One night, several years ago, I've been walking down 18th and Fairfax, between 18th and 19th Avenue.
Yes, yes.
Well, I just helped Ed Hickey into a cab. He had been mixing his rye and his gin again, and I thought I could use him in vain. After I helped him into the cab, I heard a voice from behind me say, "Hello, Mr. Dow." I turned around and there was this great big white rabbit leaning against a lamppost. Well, I didn't think anything of that, because if you've lived in this town as long as I have, you get used to the fact that everyone knows your name. So I walked over, I chatted with him some. He said to me, "Gotta be mistaken, or was Ed Hickey a little spiffed tonight?" I think the world and all of Ed, but he was spiffed. Later I said to him, "You have the advantage of me. I know your name, but you don't know mine." Right back at me he said, "Well, what name do you like?" I really didn't have to think about that for a second. Harvey had always been my favorite name, so I said Harvey. He said right back at me, "What a coincidence. Harvey happens to be my name."
Mr. Dad, what was your father's name?
John. John Frederick.
When you were young, did you have a playmate, someone with whom you spent many long, happy, carefree hours?
Yes, Doctor, didn't you?
Well, what was his name?
Vern McElhenney. Do you know the McElhenneys, Doctor?
No.
It's too bad. There were a lot of them. Never circulated. Wonderful people.
Think carefully, Dad. Wasn't there anyone you knew anywhere named Harvey?
No, I don't believe so. Maybe that's why I had such high hopes for it.
You can take him upstairs now, Wilson.
You made this your show, so run it. You just stood around here, forgetting all about the doctor. I'm taking him nowhere. You made this your show, so you run it.
Mr. Dowd, Elwood, come upstairs now.
Very well, Lyman. But I can't stay for very long. I promised Harvey to take him to the floor show.
Oh, boy.
Doctor, are you all right?
All right. Of course, boy. Someone's following me.
Who's following you, Doctor?
None of your business.
Doctor, how did you get out there? I just saw you go in there.
I went out through my window. Wilson, don't leave me.
No, Doctor.
Get that man Dowd out of here.
Yes, Doctor.
No, don't leave me.
But you said
Dumpy on the telephone.
Yeah, Dumpy, give that guy Dowd his clothes and get him down here on the double. Thanks.
No! Don't leave me!
Just a second, Doctor. Judge Gaffney.
I want to see Dr. Chumley. Chumley, we need to talk to you. This thing is serious.
It certainly is.
More serious than you suspect. Where can we go to talk?
Not in there.
The doctor doesn't want you in his office.
No, sir.
Then sit down, Dr. Chumley. Sit down, Myrtle May.
Sit down, Dr. Chumley. Sit down, Myrtle May. Don't go, Wilson. Don't leave me.
Now then, here are my notes. The facts. Can anybody hear me?
Yeah, we can all hear you. Is that good?
Now then, Dr. Chumley, has it ever occurred to you that there might possibly be something like this rabbit Harvey?
Of course there isn't, and anyone who thinks there is crazy. Well, don't look at me like that. There's nothing funny about me. I'm like my father's family. They're all dead.
Now then, on the morning of November 2nd, my client, the plaintiff, Mrs. Veda Louise Simmons, swears that while she was standing in the kitchen of her home, she heard her name called. She turned and saw this great white rabbit, Harvey. He was staring at her. Resenting the intrusion, the plaintiff made certain remarks which drove the creature away. He went.
What did she say to him?
She was emphatic. The remark's not important.
I want to know how she got this creature out of her sanitarium. I mean her home.
Hurry up, out with it. What did she say?
She looked him right in the eye and exclaimed in the heat of anger, "To hell with you!"
To hell with you! He left?
Well, yes, he left, but that's not the important thing. The important thing is this important? Is this thing important, or is it something we can cope with? Ask for your opinion, Doctor.
Ruthie, I've been looking all over for you.
Dr. Sanderson, disregard what I said this afternoon. I want you on my staff. You're a very astute young man.
Lyman!
Oh, baby!
See you later.
You just gotta keep Uncle Elwood out of the doctor. That's all there is to it.
I want the sanitarium the way it was before that man Dow came out here this afternoon.
I know what you mean.
You do?
Well, yeah. I mean, it certainly gets on anyone's nerves the way Uncle Elwood knows what's gonna happen before it happens. I mean, take this morning, for instance. Uncle Elwood told me that Harvey told him that the McElhenney's Aunt Rose was going to drop in unexpectedly from Cleveland.
And did she?
Did she what?
Did she come, just as Harvey said she would?
Yeah, but what of it? Who cares about the McElhenney's?
And you say this sort of thing happens often?
Yeah, and isn't it silly? I mean, Harvey tells Elwood everything. Harvey knows everything. How could he? When there's no such thing as Harvey.
Fly specks. I've been spending my life among fly specks while miracles have been leaning on lampposts on 18th and Fairfax.
Good. Nobody here but people.
Mother, you promise you won't come out here this afternoon.
Well, good evening. Now, Myrtle May, I brought Elwood's draft room. Well, why are you all just standing here? I thought you'd be committing him.
Sit down there, Veda Louise.
I will not sit down there.
So, Myrtle, how about me and you going out on Saturday night?
Certainly not, Myrtle May. Come here.
I'm sorry.
Is everything settled?
It will be.
Doctor, may I give my opinion?
Yes, do, by all means.
His opinion? Oh my, he's the doctor I told you about, the eyes!
Well, it's my opinion that Elwood P. Dowd is suffering from third-degree hallucination, and that the other party concerned is suffering from autosuggestion. I would recommend formula 977 for Elwood and bed rest at home.
You do?
Yes, doctor, that's my diagnosis. If we give Elwood this formula, he will not see any more rabbits. It's worked in hundreds of psychopathic cases.
Don't you call my brother a psychopathic case? There has never been anything like that in our family.
Mother, if you didn't think Uncle Elwood was psychopathic, why did you bring him out here?
Where else could I take him? I couldn't take him to jail, could I? Besides, this is not your uncle's fault. Why did Harvey have to speak to Elwood in the first place?
Don't with your oar and keep your oar out. If this shock formula brings people back to reality, give it to them. That's what we want, Elwood.
I am not sure the formula will work in a case of this kind, Doctor.
Oh, it's worked in hundreds of other cases.
Harvey always follows Elwood home.
He does?
Yes, but if you give him the formula and Elwood doesn't see Harvey, he won't let him in. Then when he comes to the door, I'll deal with him.
Mother, would you stop talking about Harvey as if there was such a thing?
Myrtle Mayor, you've got a lot to learn, and I hope you never learn it.
Shh, he's here.
Good evening.
Good evening, Elwood. I brought you your bathrobe.
Thank you, Vera.
Well, what do, Doctor? We've got to do something.
Oh, yes, we must.
I should say so.
Yes, it's imperative. Well, while you're all waiting, why don't we all go down to Charlie's and have a drink?
You're not going anywhere, Elwood. You're staying here.
Yeah, Uncle Elwood.
Yeah, stay here, son.
I plan to leave. You won't want me to stay. An element of conflict is a good thing in any situation. It means everyone's taking part and no one's left out. I like that. Oh, how did it go with you and Harvey, Doctor?
Shh! We're waiting for your decision, Doctor.
What?
What is your answer?
I must be alone with this man. We all step into the other room. I'll have my diagnosis in a moment.
Do hurry, Doctor.
I will.
You stay here, Edward.
How are you, Doctor?
I'm good. May I give you this chair, Mr. Dowd? May I give you this cigar? Is there anything else I can get you?
What do you have in mind?
Mr. Dowd, what kind of man are you? Where do you come from?
Didn't I give you one of my cards?
And where on the face of this tired old earth did you find a thing like him?
Harvey the Pooka?
Is it true that he has a function that he...
gets advanced on us? I'm happy to say it is. Harvey's versatile. Harvey can stop clocks.
What?
You've heard the expression, his face can stop a clock.
Yes. But Harvey's, why? To what purpose?
Harvey says he can just blow the clock and set it right down and there.
And does he do this for you?
He is willing to at any time. But thus far, I've not found a time where I'd like to stop time and go wherever I wanted.
I know where I go.
Where?
I go to Akron.
Akron?
There's a cottage camp outside Akron and a grove of maple trees. Cool, green, beautiful.
My favorite tree.
I go there with a pretty young woman. A quiet woman. A strange woman.
Under a tree?
I wouldn't even want to know her name. I'd be just Mr. Brown.
Why wouldn't you want to know the woman's name? You might be acquainted with the same people.
I would tell things no one has ever heard before. Things that are locked in here. And then, I would send out the cold beer.
No whiskey?
Beer is better.
Maybe under a tree. But she might like a highball.
As I talked, I wanted to reach out a soft white hand, stroke my hair, and say, poor thing. Oh, you poor, poor thing.
How long would you go on like this?
2 weeks.
2 weeks? Wouldn't that get monotonous? Just Akron, poor, poor thing, and cold beer for 2 weeks?
No, no. It would be wonderful.
Doctor, I can't help but think you're making a mistake, not allowing the woman to talk. And if she gets around at all, she might have picked up some very interesting little news items. And I'm sure you're making a mistake with all that beer and that whiskey. But it's your 2 weeks.
Cold beer at Akron and one last fling. God, man.
Doctor, would you like to lie down?
No. Tell me, Mr. Dowd. Could he? Would he do this for me?
He could and he might. I never heard Harvey say a word against Akron. By the way, Doctor, where is Harvey?
Why, you don't know?
The last time I saw him, he was with you.
Ah.
Oh, he's probably down at Charlie's.
That's it. He's down at Charlie's.
Excuse me, Doctor.
No, Mr. Dow, not there.
Dr. Shumley, I couldn't leave without saying goodbye to my dear friend, Dr. Sanderson.
Mr. Dow, Dr. Sanderson is not your friend. None of these people are your friends. I am your friend.
Thank you, and I am yours.
And this sister of yours, She's at the bottom of this conspiracy against you. Today, she had commitment papers drawn up. She's got the key to your safety box and your power of attorney. She brought you out here.
Better than all that in one afternoon? She's certainly a whirlwind.
God, man! Haven't you any righteous indignation?
Doctor, my mother used to say to me, in this world, Elwood, she always called me Elwood. In this world, you have to be oh so smart or oh so pleasant. For years I was smart. I'd recommend pleasant. And you may quote me on that.
Just the same. I will protect you, Mr. Dowd, even if I have to commit her. Would you like me to do that?
No, Doctor. Not unless you wanted to. Not unless I wanted to stay out here and liked it out here. Not to say you don't have a nice place, but I think Ben would be better off with me and Harvey and Myrtle May. Miss Kelly, the modern greatest ever enchanted this enlightening place. Oh, it's fifth allergy. My dear, you never look lovelier.
I'll never feel happier, Mr. Dodd. I know it.
Wow!
Doctor?
I wonder if I can remember any more of that poem.
This rabbit gag might be a good one. Kelly never kissed me.
Elvin's always my favorite poet.
Okay, pal, you're discharged.
Wilson! Get your hands off that man!
Him? The guy with the rabbit?
Apologize to Mr. Dow! Apologize!
I'm sorry. Now, this is the door.
If I leave, I'll remember.
Mr. Dowd, do women often come up to you and kiss you just as Miss Kelly did?
Every once in a while. I encourage it, too.
To hell with decency. I've got to have this rabbit. Go ahead and knock.
Thank you.
Mr. Dowd.
Dr. Sanderson.
Do you agree with my diagnosis?
Yes, I do. Call them all in.
Come in, please.
Is it settled?
Yes. I find I concur with Dr. Sanderson.
Oh, that's wonderful. What a relief.
Good boy.
Well, let's celebrate. I happen to have some bars listed in the back of this book.
This injection carries a violent reaction. I can't give it to him without his consent. Will he give it?
Of course he will. I ask him. Don't ask him. Just give it to him.
To give up this rabbit? I doubt it.
Bessie's barn dance, Blondie's chicken in.
Elwood!
Better late than ever it is. We should call and order a table. How many of us will it be, Bella?
Oh, Elwood!
Mr. Dowd, I have a formula 977 that will be good for you. Will you take it?
Elwood, you won't see this rabbit anymore.
But you will see your responsibilities, your duties.
Well, if you suggested it, Doctor, it must be a very good thing. If I should happen to run into anyone who needs it, I'll be sure to recommend it. For myself, I wouldn't care for it.
Hear that, Judge! Hear that, Doctor! That's what we have to put up with!
Bella, do you want me to take this?
Elwood, I'm only thinking of you. You're my brother. I've known you for years. I'd do anything for you. That Harvey wouldn't do anything for you. He's making a fool out of you, Elwood. Don't be a fool.
Oh, I won't.
Why, you could amount to something. You could be sitting on the Western Slope Water Board right now if you'd only go over there and ask them.
Very well, Bella. If that's what you want, me and Harvey will go over there tomorrow and ask him.
Tomorrow? I never want to see another tomorrow. Not if Myrtle May and I have to live in a house with that rabbit. Our friends never come to see us. We have no social life. We have no life at all. We're both miserable. I wish I were dead, but maybe you don't care.
Well, we've felt better she had everything she wants. Bella, you sure? Very well, Doctor. Where do I go?
In Sanderson's office, Dowd.
You will say goodbye to the old Philip for me, won't you?
How long will this take, Doctor?
Oh, just a couple of minutes. You can wait up here.
All right.
Dr. Sanderson said it wouldn't take long.
Now, Mother, don't fidget.
Oh, how can I help it?
Mother, how stunning.
without paying me.
Oh, yes, I forgot. How much is it?
I'll be out here from town. $2.75.
$2.75? I could have sworn I brought my coin purse. Where is it? Myrtle, do you have any money?
No, I spent the last money Uncle Ella gave me on my new hairdo for the party.
Judge, do you have $2.75 I could borrow to pay this cab driver?
Sorry, nothing but a check.
We don't take checks.
I know.
Dr. Chumley, do you happen to have $2.75 I could borrow to pay the cab driver?
I don't seem to have my wallet. I don't have time to go. I have to get out this injection, sorry.
Well, I'll get it for you from my brother. But I can't get it right now. He's in there to get an injection. It won't be long. You'll have to wait.
You're gonna get my money from your brother, and he's in there to get some of that stuff they shoot out here.
It won't be long.
Lady, I want my money now.
I said it would only be a few minutes. I want you to drive us back to town anyway.
And I told you, I want my money now, or I'm going to cab back to town, and you can wait for the bus at 6 in the morning.
Well, of all the pig-headed, stubborn things!
I should say so.
What's the matter with you?
Nothing that $2.75 won't fix. You heard me. Take it or leave it.
I've never heard anything so unreasonable in my life. Dr. Chumley, will you let Elwood step out here a minute? This cab driver won't wait.
Don't be too long, Mr. Dowd.
Elwood, I came off without my coin purse. Will you give this woman $2.75? But don't give her any more. She's been very rude.
How do you do? That is my name.
Lofgren's mine, EJ.
It's nice to meet you, Miss Lofgren. This is Judge Gaffney, Dr. Shumley, my sister, Mrs. Simmons, and my charming little niece, Myrtle May.
Hi.
Have you lived around here long, Miss Lofgren?
Yeah, I lived around here all my life.
Do you enjoy your work?
It's okay. I've been with Apex Cabs 15 years, and my brother Joe's been driving for Brown pretty near 12.
You drive for Apex, and your brother Joe drives for Browns? That's interesting, isn't it, Badge? Hurry up, Mr. Dowd. Miss Lofgren, my sister and my niece live with me at this address here. Why don't you and your brother come and have dinner with us sometime?
Sure, be glad to.
What? Why would you be glad to?
I wouldn't come any night but Tuesday. I'm on duty all the rest of the week.
Then you must come Tuesday. I'll expect you to come for dinner. It'll end it.
Elwood, I'm sure this woman has friends of her own.
Better, we can never have too many friends.
Don't keep Dr. Chumley waiting. That's rude.
Very well. Here you go. Keep the change. Will you excuse me now?
Sure. A sweet guy.
Certainly. You could just as well have waited.
Oh, no. Listen, lady. I've been driving this route 15 years. I brought him out here to get that stuff and brought him back after they had it. It changes them.
Well, I certainly hope so.
And you again. On the way out here, they sit back and enjoy the ride. They talk to me. Sometimes we stop and watch the sunsets and look at the birds flying. Sometimes we stop and watch the birds when there ain't no birds and look at the sunsets when it's raining. We have a swell time and I always get a big tip. But afterwards, uh-oh.
Afterwards, uh-oh? What do you mean by afterwards, uh-oh?
They crab, crab, crab. They yell at me to watch the lights, watch the brakes, watch the intersections. They got no faith in me or my buggy. It's the same cab, the same driver, and we're going back over the very same route. It's no fun and no tips.
But my brother would have tipped you anyway. He's very generous, always has been.
Not after this, he won't be, lady. After this, he'd be a perfectly normal human being, and you know what bastards they are. Glad I met you. I'll wait.
Oh, Judge Gaffney, Myrtle May, stop it! Stop it, don't give it to him! Elwood, come out of there!
You can't do that. Dr. Chumley's given the injection.
I don't want Elwood to have it. I don't want Elwood that way. I don't like people like that.
Judge Meeker, stop. Mother, stop it.
You shut up. I will live longer than you. I remember my father. I remember your father. I remember.
What's this? What's all the commotion?
She wants to stop the injection.
What's the matter, Doctor? She sounded off again.
You haven't already given it to him, have you?
No, we're about to. Wilson, take Mrs. Simmons away.
Leave me alone! Take your hands off me, you white slaver!
You don't know what you want. You didn't want that rabbit either.
And what's wrong with Harvey? If Elwood and Myrtle May and I want to live with Harvey, it's nothing to you. You don't even have to come around. It's our business. Elwood!
There, Vetta. Vetta's all tired out. She's had a long day.
Have it your own way. I'm not giving up my game at the club again, no matter how big the animal is.
Come on, Elwood. Let's get out of here. I hate this place. I wish I'd never seen it.
But Mrs. Simmons...
It's whatever Vetta says, Doctor.
Why, look at this. It must have been here the whole time. I could have paid that cab driver myself. Harvey! Come on, Myrtle May. Come on, Elwood.
Goodbye, Mr. Chumley. Goodbye, Mr. Wilson.
Come along, Elwood.
Dr. Chumley, I've known for years my family thinks of Harvey, but I've often wondered what Harvey's family thinks of me. Oh, there you are! Excuse me, Doctor. You're standing in the way. Where have you been? I've been looking all over for you. Call our director, Mr. Katie. Mr. Katie. Come on up here.
Come on, you know you want it.
Crew, we'd like to congratulate you for
putting up with us.
Thank you.
But not putting this, we want to thank you too.
We would like to congratulate
this man, backbone of this performance. I mean that in a good way.
Go home, it's late. Okay, Maria, you can kill the lights, bring up the house. Let's get.
Is
climb some fences, scratching and crawling along the floor to touch you. And just when it feels right, you say you found someone to hold you. Does she